especially that's a very, I mean, an age and an era where, you know, the emotions are full, right? So during this pandemic, youngsters need to be properly channeled, properly challenged, so that they could really live a fragrant life for the Lord. So this is this meeting is organized because many children have asked. So I'm so happy if you have come and many are on the way. So may the Lord help all of us to have a great time. And even as we sang all the songs talk about the Lord Jesus Christ and talk about what a faithful friend he is, right? No matter how unfaithful we are, the Lord is ever so faithful, nurturing us and loving us every moment and protecting us and keeping us very safe, right? Sometimes, even as elderly people, when we just sit back and think as to how the Lord has been so faithful during our formative years, you know, I understand even as a few mothers are also there, we understand the age you're going through is a very turbulent age. It's a very challenging age. It's a very challenging phase of your life where everything is to the highest, okay? And this is when you need to be channeled. This is when you need to be really hooked on to the Lord Jesus Christ. And Lord Jesus Christ is the rock on which our lives are built.
Right?
So even as we take this journey for the next 45 minutes, may the Lord help all of us. You know, it's not me who's talking. No matter how much I prepare, no matter how much I try to write notes and deliver the message to you, unless the Lord helps, unless the Lord anoints, unless the Lord speaks from heaven, you know, it goes down the drain, right? So even as we are in this Zoom session, I want to tell you that we have been through your age, the age you are through. The Zoom sessions, the heading was for the young girls, okay? So we as elderly people, we know what it means to go through this young phase, okay? This turbulent phase, the phase of teens and the phase of young adult, you know, there's so many emotions involved in that. And by God's grace, all the grown-ups like us have been channeled in the proper way when we were of your age. Otherwise, we would be in the world and our lives would be very bad as of now, you know. But somebody out there, some God servant and some elderly sisters and brothers, some pastors and some cousins and some aunts and uncles and some godly people were guiding us, and that's the reason. And we have listened to their voice. I mean, we have listened, and see, it's one thing to listen to the message and totally a different thing to follow it, right? That's why the Lord says, do not be just hearers of the word, but doers of the word. The problem comes, there's so much of word, delivered to us all along during different sessions. But the problem comes when we do not actually act accordingly. That's where the problem comes, okay? So whatever it is, we are in this journey, and may the Lord help all of us. May the Lord help me especially, so that, you know, the Lord could really bring out things which are very applicable to the youngsters. Even as we go on this journey, I just want to read one verse from Psalm 144, 12th verse, okay? Psalm 144, it's a very beautiful verse. When I was a youngster, this verse spoke to me volumes. And this verse made me really strong in the Lord. This beautiful verse taught me what I am in the sight of the Lord. It says 140, I think all of it's a very familiar verse. And I'm sure you must have heard many messages based on this verse, okay? It's a beautiful verse. I'll read it for you. I'm reading from NKJV version, okay? NKJV, because KJV also is good. But for the youngsters, it's more applicable and it's easy to read. So I'm reading from NKJV, okay? So that's 144, 12th verse. The second part, that our daughters may be as pillars sculptured in palace style. I'll read again, that our daughters may be as pillars sculptured in palace style. Part A says that our sons may be plants grown up in their youth, okay? We'll say a short prayer. Heavenly Father, we praise and we worship you. And we come to you this evening. Thank you for what all you have done for us, Father. We stand in awe of you, Lord. What a splendor, what splendor you are, Father. You all your majesty, you know, in all your Shekinah glory, Lord, you are always worshipped. Holy, holy, holy is the Lamb, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for being, Lord Jesus, a great Savior, a Redeemer for us, Father, and especially as youngsters. We thank you for being an ever faithful friend, Father, understanding all our craziest thoughts, Lord Jesus, and trying to, Lord Jesus, make us, Lord Jesus, be transformed in your image, Father. We thank you, Lord. Even as we, Lord Jesus, look to you, Father, and even as we look, Lord Jesus, into your holiness, into the beauty of your holiness, Lord Jesus, we wonder as to why you have, Lord Jesus, thought about what is it in us, Lord, that you have really thought so beautiful about us, Father. You've given us a beautiful life, Lord. You've given us beautiful countenance, Lord. You've given us beautiful body, Lord. And you've given us, Lord Jesus, beautiful life, Father. What is it that you are mindful of us, Father? We thank you. Lord Jesus, we thank you for helping us to be to organize Zoom meeting, Lord, where many youngsters, many of us are here, Father. We thank you. Even as, Lord Jesus, we, Lord Jesus, take this journey of trying to understand, Lord Jesus, the, what we are in your sight, Father. Your word says in Psalm 144, 12, Lord Jesus, that as youngsters, Lord, as your daughters and as daughters of our parents, Lord, Lord Jesus, you compare us with pillars, Lord Jesus, sculptured for a big palace, Father. Oh, what a great joy it is, Lord, to understand, Lord, that you think of us so great, Father. We thank you, Lord Jesus. Be with all of us. Help none of us in the Zoom session to leave this Zoom session without anything, Father. Help all of us to carry beautiful, Lord Jesus, spiritual thoughts, Lord Jesus, Lord Jesus, beautiful lessons, Lord, so that we could really apply the word into our lives. Father, thank you once again for this beautiful time, Lord. Be with the ones who are yet to join, Lord Jesus, and be with us. Give us a beautiful time. This we ask in the most precious name of our Savior and Lord Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay. So even as we go on with the message, wherever I go, usually when I take the youth meeting or the young girls meeting, I would like to, Lord Jesus, I would like to define what we are, okay? Even if we understand what the Lord is trying to give us or what the Lord is trying to teach us, we need to understand what we are. Okay? As I told you, there's some mothers here present, and we know we have been through your age, right? We have been through this age, or the age of young adult and teens. And we know what it means to be tempted, what it means to have a battle. I know, I understand this life, what you're going through is a life of big battle, you know. You try to do something and something happens, you're distracted, and sometimes you're channeled, but again you're distracted. So sometimes this walk with the Lord, the spiritual walk with the Lord, especially in this age, is very tough. And no matter how hard you try to be holy, you end up being unholy. No matter how many resolutions you make, we end up breaking the resolution in the very second hour. I am like that, you know. The person who's talking to you has been a very bad girl, has been a girl who never kept up her promises she made to the Lord. I always said, Lord, every day I'll read 5 chapters, and I end up reading not even 1 chapter. And in spite of me being so unfaithful, my God has been so faithful. He has been so faithful. He doesn't look at how much I pray. He doesn't look at how much I read the Bible. He doesn't judge me by what spiritual things I do. He just looks at me and says, you are an awesome child of mine. You are a beautiful child of mine. And the more I look at you, I behold beauty, so much of beauty in you. So sometimes I think, Lord, why? What is it that you have seen in me that you loved me so much? You've not only given me the great mystery of the gospel of Christ, you've helped me to understand the mystery of the gospel of Christ, of yours, Lord. And you also blessed me with so many beautiful things, Lord, and I'm so worthy. So even as I just go on with the scripture from Psalm 144, 12, I would like to define myself. When I was almost maybe 30 years back, when I was of your age, I would define myself like this. You know, we are, because I cannot say I'm in youth, I'm not a youth anymore, okay? So, but you are youth, right? You are in the prime time of your youth, and you are you're in a phase where everything is at the peak. Okay. So I would like to define what youth is, Y-O-U-T-H, right? So I would like to define each word. Each word says Y is, just a minute, the, okay. Just a minute, I have some problem here. Okay. So Y-O-U, so keep your, I mean, somebody who has heard me earlier would have known this, but no matter where I go, I would like to define this youth. Y-O-U-T-H is, even as I mention what each word stands for, I think you will agree with me, okay? So this is nothing but what youth is in short. So Y is, the spelling is, you could write it down on your book, Y-O-U-T-H, right? So Y, it says, because I told you this definition for each letter for the word youth, I have written out of experience, because what I was earlier 30 years ago. So Y is, we yield to many things. Yield in the sense, we say yes to everything, okay? Suppose a friend says, maybe I'm talking to the wrong crowd, but let me define what youth is, okay? So we yield to many things. We yield to emotions, okay? If friends say, come on, go, let's go for a movie. Maybe many of you have not gone, you know, but, you know, we feel like going, okay? We feel to emotions. Suppose a guy comes and says, I love you. We feel so, you know, we feel so tempted also. Okay, maybe we do not say yes to them, but whatever it is, in our heart and mind, we yield to many few things. We are weak in many things. Okay, but I'm going to show you many scriptures where the Lord says, you are not weak, you are very strong. For when I am weak, then am I strong. So why is we yield to many things? Okay, now cell phone has become a greatest temptation of all, okay, for elders and even for youngsters. Okay, so posting our pictures. We yield to, like, you know, making friends with others. So many things. In the sense, this phase is a phase where you're in the formative years, okay? Your emotions are being formed. There's a lot of change happening in your body and the emotions are taking their toll and the hormones are at the peakest, okay? And this is the reason, mentally and physically, emotionally, psychologically, we yield to many things, okay? We yield to fashion. We yield to the modern trends. We yield to going out with friends and, you know, we have this peer pressure because other friends are doing that way. Why cannot I? Facebook is a deal to Facebook and all the social media. So there are many things, you know, these are playing havoc with the youngsters. You know, if you post a picture in the Facebook or in the social media, I don't know what happened. I don't know how many useless people will look into our posts and, you know, they try to create problems for us. So why is we yield to many things? We yield to many temptations in the world. And O is, the letter O stands for ostentatious. We are very ostentatious. I would ask you one thing, everybody in the Zoom now present here, before you came to the Zoom, all of us must have looked at ourselves in the mirror, okay? Even I have done that. You know, earlier I had two sessions and I had to change my clothes and, you know, be presentable before I come here. So all of us definitely would have looked into the mirror. Maybe not for this meeting, at least in the morning you would have. Okay? Not only youngsters, even older people try to look into the mirror and they try to see if their hair is okay, their hairdo is okay, their skin is okay, their powder is okay. So O is ostentatious. And as women and as young girls and as teens, we want to be very ostentatious. What does the word ostentatious mean? It means we want to be, Hindi mein bolte na, 100, in the crowd of 100, we want to stand apart. Our dressing way, the way we look, the structure, our height and everything. We want to look apart and we want to look very special. And we want to look very, very fashionable. If somebody would say, hey man, among all those 100 people, you're the most beautiful girl. I tell you that will make our day, right? So ostentatious, we want to look good. We want to look presentable, very good. We have to be modest. We want to be presentable. We have to be presentable. But at the same time, not only that, we want to look outstanding. You know, I was a lecturer earlier before I came to serve the Lord. Okay. And then now this illustration is, to let you know what ostentatious mean, okay? So I was teaching and, you know, in every class, there are these back benches, you know, monkeys who don't listen to the teacher at all, okay? So there was a gang of students who would never listen, okay? So to make it very tough for them, I said, tomorrow I'm going to give a sudden test and you make sure you study well and you get good marks because I'm going to add those marks in the assessment, okay? So then all of them screamed, ma'am, they said. I said, no. I'm going to have an exam exactly tomorrow. It's a sudden test, okay? So the next morning, I went as usual to my college. I had oil in my hair. And when I was getting onto the steps, this one monkey from the class, you know, the back benches, this girl comes to me and says, madam, Annie madam, today you're looking very beautiful, okay? What did she tell me? She are looking very beautiful. Actually, I know how I was looking that day. I had a normal dress. I had oil in my hair and I was just normal. But what did she say? You're looking beautiful. I tell you, dear children, the moment she said that, the moment she complimented me about my beauty, my heart missed a beat and I thought I'm the Barbie of the world, right? So every girl wants to be called your most beautiful. We want to look ostentatious. We want to look better than them. You know, we want to look, our dressing should be much more better than them. And the way, you know, our face also should be much better than them. And we try to compare a lot, you know. So ostentatious is, O is, we are very ostentatious. That is the second definition of youth. Okay. I hope you all agree. Okay. And then U is, Y-O-U, right? U is unstable. This age is an age where we are very unstable. Because I told you earlier, we are in the formative years. That's the reason we are very unstable. Okay, spiritually we are unstable. Academically we are unstable. Physically we are unstable. One day we deck up very nicely. The other day we are so lazy we don't even comb our hair. Okay, and sometimes we don't even take a shower. Okay, so there are two extremes. We are very unstable. One day we're very spiritual, with the day we feel very close to the Lord, we sing out a song to the Lord and we read 10 chapters and we pray for 2 hours and we are so good, we have a good feeling. The next day when something bad comes up, we just abandon prayer, we don't read the Bible. Okay, this I'm talking about myself, you know. So we are in a haphazard way, we're not balanced. So someday, one day, like, you know, this is my friend. The other day, if she troubles me, she's not my friend, okay? Even in a friendship, we are unstable, okay? Even in our relationship with relatives, we are unstable. So in everything, this age is an age where we are unstable. You're not still formed, you're not still strong, you know? So this is the reason why I'm telling you, this is the time when we need to have the great anchor, Lord Jesus Christ, okay? So we are very unstable in everything. I think you can tell me much more, you know, many more anecdotes than I'm able to tell, you know, because these were the things when I learned as a youngster. So we are very unstable in everything, okay? One day, we are given a room in our house. One day we keep our room so beautifully. We deck it up with lights, you know, and we clean our bed and all our clothes are piled up in the cupboard and our shoes are in order, our books are in order. And one day we are lazy, our whole room is, you know, it's like railway station, right? We don't keep, sometimes, you know, we don't even make sure that we fold the blanket we have used in the night. So that's how we are. And we are unstable. Praise God, don't worry. We don't have to worry, because don't think these are negative. But just because I'm just defining, these are the things which I learned in my life. Do not think Anant is talking all negative about us. No, I'm not talking negative about, but I'm just telling, drawing the point that we are weak, and this weak vessel is in the mighty hands of God. The God of the universe, the God of the Shekinah glory, is a God who understands how weak you are. He understands how weak I am. He understands how precious we are. He understands. He says, you are weak, my child. I know you are weak in this world. And I know in spite of all the temptations, you're trying very hard to have a good spiritual life. In spite of all the temptation, in spite of all the trauma in the world, in spite of all the chaos in the world, you are making it very, very easy for you to stand for me. I'm acknowledging that, but remember, you are in the mighty hands of God. That's what the Lord is saying, okay? So, and T is Y-O-U, right? T is temptation, the many temptations. If I would ask all the youngsters in the Zoom session, if you would say, please raise your hand if there's any young girl who has not had been tempted so far. Is there anybody else? Is there anybody who would say, Annie auntie, I've not been tempted in my life at all. Is there anybody like that? No, because I know if you're saying that, then I'm sure there's nobody raising your hand, because if you're saying you're not being tempted for anything, then it's a lie, because all of us are tempted. When Christ himself was here on this earth as a man, as 100% divine and as 100% man, he was tempted. He was tempted 3 times. And every time he was tempted, he used the word of God. So all of us, Y-O-U-T is temptations. We have a lot of temptations. And if I would give you the time to tell you what are temptations you are facing so far, I tell you they would be many. There's so many temptations compared to how we were youngsters 30 years back. The kind of temptations you have is more. You are in a more dangerous zone than we were earlier in 30 years back. Okay, so temptations, there's so many temptations. Temptations from the world, temptations from the affairs of the world, temptation from friends, temptation from the social network, temptations from so many things, okay? So, but praise God, every temptation, the Lord is able to help us to overcome it, because we are in the mighty hands of God. And H, the last word, H is, we have high expectation, you know? High expectation in the sense, we feel so great about ourselves, and we live in a fantasy world. Everything is fantasy, you know? Everything is, you know, these comics, in comics, Tinkle or whatever we read, you know, when some guy is thinking, it's like bubbles, and then he imagines, right? So this high expectation is, youngsters live in a world of fantasy. They live in a world of, you know, illusion. You think, oh my God, I'm the most beautiful girl. When I become big, I'll become a big officer. And I'm going to, so they live in a dream. Youngsters like you live in a world of dreams, you know. Dreams, and you think, oh my God, see, I'm the greatest of all. Yes, it's good to think that we are good enough, you know. But when the problem comes, when you live in a world of fantasy, when reality hits you, like a big blow, you know, when like a big rock, you know, you're disappointed. You think, you know, oh my God, what is there? I can get 98%. But when the truth comes, even 75 comes, and that's the reason youngsters, they get into depression, because they build their castles in the air. And when they do not come into reality, youngsters, they do get depressed, you know. And that's the reason the H is like high expectation. To make the long story short, there was this young girl, you know. I was having a meeting like this. The point was, you know, we were discussing on the topic of marriage. And then I said, did you ever think what kind of a husband you want? Okay. And then one girl raises her hand. She says, Akka, I'll tell you, Akka. I'll tell you what kind of a husband I want. Okay. So because you are youngsters, it is the right time. It could be a right time also because you're in the teens also. Maybe to pray for that. Okay, that comes later. But what the point? That's not the point. So this girl said, I'll come. So I gave the mic and she said, Akka, this anecdote, this real story I'm telling you because I want to draw to everybody's attention the aspect of high expectation. Okay. So this girl was around doing her intermediate and she said, Akka, she took the mic and she said, Akka, I should be wearing a nice pink Barbie, gown, Akka. And I should be in a garden with all flowers and roses and lilies and all flowers, beautiful flowers. And I should be just taking the flowers and smelling it. And by the side of the garden, there should be a big road, Akka. And even as I'm in the park with a big hat and the Barbie gown, I'm picking up flowers. And there comes one tall, dark and handsome guy on a horse. And he should be tuck, 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 tuck. He should come. And the moment he looks at me, he should think, wow, kya baat hai, what a girl. Akka, and he should get down. Akka, and he should come running to me. He should kneel down on his feet. And he should say, oh, my beloved, charming, darling, will you marry me? Okay. That's the kind of expectations youngsters have. They have high expectations. I tell you, after your meeting, ask your mommy if your daddy came on a horse to ask your mommy to get her married to him. No, that's a world of fantasy. Okay, so H is like very high expectation. So these are the things I just told you as a kickstart, so that we could just start off this beautiful verse. It says Psalm 144. Okay, so I'm sure you all agree. We are in this stage. You know, we yield to many things. We are ostentatious. We are unstable. And we have temptations and we have high expectation. But in spite of all that, the Lord is very gracious. He's going to help us through. And you're going to come out as successful children. And I'm sure you're going to really, anchor your life on the rock Jesus Christ. Okay, now we'll read Psalm 144, 12th verse. It says that our daughters may be as pillars. Pillars are sculptured in palace style, okay? So this imagine, we all think, you know, we are weak, you know, as of now, when we define the word youth, Y-O-U-T-H, it looks like that me or you are thinking that we are weak. Yes, we are weak. But what the Lord say, you might be weak, my child, physically, because the way we are built up is totally different from how we are built up from boys, right? So we are built up in a different way and the way we are built up is totally different, okay? And our perspective is different, our thinking is different, the way we react to situations is different. But whatever it is the Lord is saying, you could be physically weak, but remember, I have made you as a pillar. Our daughters are like pillars. This I imagine like this. Suppose in the middle of many roads, there's a big building, okay, like a palace. And that palace has a lot of pillars. And that palace is in the midst of many roads where many people who are passing by are looking at the palace, okay? And the palace is very magnificent. It's very palatial. It's beautiful. And kings and queens come to the palace and go to see that big palace. It's standing in the midst of many roads and everybody is beholding it. And the Lord says, my dear daughter, my dear young girl, my dear child, my dear teen, my dear young adult, you know what you are? You are one of the pillars built for that palace. That means we are very strong. Remember, the palace which is in the midst of many roads, it's very prominent, okay? It seems to be very royal, okay? And many dignitaries are looking at it and many dignitaries are coming into that palace and everybody is beholding. So even as we are in his presence, may the Lord help all of us to understand that we are pillars, built for his glory. We are pillars built for his glory and for his honor. Today, the Lord says you are a pillar. And because I've kept everybody mute, this pillar, you know, the whole palace is built and these pillars are the supporting supporting what I can supporting structures for the whole palace. Can you imagine somebody building a big complex? We have seen many complexes coming up. And for the complex to be very strong, it all depends on the pillars. Okay, just right behind our house, there has been almost 10 years back, there was a very big apartment built, almost 40 apartments were built. I mean, the whole one building had 40 apartments. And everybody joined and everybody, occupied the apartment. And one fine day at 10 o'clock in the morning, the whole building collapsed, almost one stair or one story down into the ground. And by God's grace, nobody died. Everybody just ran out, you know. But there was a lot of chaos. The reason why that whole big palatial building collapsed, the reason was because the foundation was not proper, because the pillars were not properly put, because the pillars were not, the iron which they used for the pillars was not good, and the concrete which they used for the pillars was not good. So the reason why the whole 40 apartment building collapsed, the reason was because the pillars were not strong. Okay, today the pillar which, I mean, the palace which the Lord is talking about in Psalm 144, for the palace to be strong, for the palace to be sculptured properly, the pillars are the secret. Today, you and I, we belong to a family, okay? We have mom, we have our parents, we have our siblings, we have our brothers and sisters, we have our full generation, we have a clan, and we have our kith and kin. And do you remember, do you understand the Lord is saying, amongst all this, we are strong pillars. We are strong pillars emotionally for our parents. We are strong pillars emotionally and physically for our parents. Imagine a boy is there in the house and the boy doesn't even care to keep the hall and the house clean. Okay, but when a girl is there, we keep it clean, right? So this pillar, it talks about great strength. It talks about great royalty. It talks about great strength and honor. So even as we talk about this verse, may the Lord help us to understand that we are mighty pillars in the hand of the Lord. Okay, so I would just I will not give you many scriptures, but few scriptures here and there what the pillar talks about. Today, even as you and I are pillars in our houses, pillars in our families, pillars in our church, and go to see, the Lord is also calling us. We can always, on a different version, we can also compare this pillar to be a pillar in the palace of the Lord. What is the palace of the Lord? The church. So maybe the Lord is referring you and me to be great pillars of strength and of honor in the church of God. So we have a job to do. We have a great ministry to do. And we are not weak vessels, you know, just thrown here and there. But we are great pillars to be in the hands of the Lord to be used for him. Okay. I would like to read one scripture from Genesis 28, 18 to 22. What does a pillar indicate in the Bible? Okay. What does a pillar indicate in the scriptures? Okay, when there are many scriptures, hundreds of scriptures depicting the honor and the greatness of the pillar, but only for our lesson, because I'll be keep it very short, I'll just give you four references. The first one is Genesis 28, 18th verse to 22nd verse. It says, Jacob, he set it as a pillar and he called that pillar as Bethel, the house of God. Okay, so when the Lord is referring you and me as a young girl, he's referring you and me as a pillar, the Lord is wanting this pillar to be like Bethel. And what is that Bethel? It's a Bethel, it's a house of God. And what does the house of God mean? It's the presence of the Lord. So today, what a wonderful thought it is that the Lord is asking you and me to be a pillar set up, you know, so that, you know, the Lord could fellowship with us. So today, what the Lord is asking us, even as he's made you and me as a pillar, he's asking you and me to fellowship with him. What a beautiful thing it is to fellowship with the Lord, you know. Even at this age, by now, as a young girl, you should be able to spend time with the Lord minimum 1 hour. If so far you have not been doing that, problem is on your way. And we are not, you know, we are going to, our lives are going to be chaotic, because by this time you have to be, by this time we have to be, the young girls need to be on our knees at least 1 hour praying and fellowshipping with the Lord. But go to see, there are many youngsters. I don't know about you. I don't know about youngsters in the group, in the Zoom group, how many are you doing that? But I've seen many young girls, the moment they wake up, they pick up the cell to see what their friend's statuses are and what Twitter says, what Instagram says, what WhatsApp message is there. And they're so inquisitive to see, look into the, or to log into the cell than spending time with the Lord, you know. And on the other hand, there's one more danger, you know, many young girls who are Christians, as soon as they get up, they just kneel down just because they have to do it, because they've been tuned to look to the Lord the moment you wake up, and it's become a monotonous. Two dangers. One is, some youngsters, as soon as they wake up, they look up the cell, they do not look to the Lord. And the other group is, they do look to the Lord, but they look in a monotonous way. For youngsters, spirituality has become monotonous. Bible reading has become monotonous. Praying has become monotonous. Singing songs has become monotonous. How many youngsters or even people like us, sometimes we don't even realize what we are singing. You know, when we are singing beautiful songs of the Lord, seldom do we understand the words. Seldom do we even apply the lyrics to our minds. No, we just monotonously sing, monotonously pray. Monotony is a very dangerous situation. Here it says, you know, Genesis 28:18-22, he says, Jacob fellowshiped with the Lord. He set up, I'll read it again, 18th verse. Then Jacob rose early in the morning and took the stone that he had put at his head, set it up as a pillar and poured oil on top of it, okay? And he called the name of that place Bethel, okay? And Bethel, we know that's the house of God. Imagine he put it up as a pillar. And what is the word of God says? Pillar is none but you and me, right? So this pillar is a pillar of fellowship. The Lord wants to fellowship with us. The Lord wants you and me to talk to him. The Lord, as soon as he wakes up, you know, as soon as we wake, the Lord has been watching over us all through the night. He's been gently caressing us. He's gently been very good to us. He has been, mothers will understand this. You know, when you were a small babe, ask your mommy after this, okay? When you were a small babe, when you were sleeping, mommy would not sleep. Mommy would look at you. Even as the sleeping child is beautifully, peacefully sleeping, mommy would caress her head, you know, caress her hair, touch the cheeks, look at the mouth, look at the nose, and really wonder, is this a child I have born? I mean, is this a child I gave birth to? Your mother was so thrilled when she looked at you sleeping. When a child is eating, the mother, you should look at the face of the mother. When the child eats good, the mother is happy. So even as your spiritual, physical mother took great delight in you, imagine what the God of heaven would think about you. When you sleep, the Lord is thrilled. When you utter a word of praise to him, he's amazed. When you talk to him from the bottom of your heart, he's just thrilled. He takes great pleasure when you and I fellowship with him. As a pillar, Jacob has set it up as a pillar. And he just called it the house of God or Bethel. Today the Lord is asking you and me, the moment you and I spend time with the Lord, the more we spend time with the Lord, the more blessed we are. I would like to illustrate one small example. You know, remember the first pillar is, we'll just learn four points and we'll stop, okay? So the first one, pillar, means the fellowship of God, okay? There was this Alsatian dog owned by a great major. He was a retired guy. Okay, and every morning, this hefty guy, you know, would take the Alsatian dog for a walk in the morning. Okay, and after a long time of walk and fellowship, both would come home, and army officer would sit in a rocking chair. He would have his hot, fuming coffee, and he would read the newspaper. Okay, and the Alsatian dog is sitting at the feet of the master. And right in front of the dog, there's one big chunk of meat. Okay, yummy meat cooked only for the dog. And this major says, okay, maybe the Alsatian dog is Johnny, okay? Johnny, this meat is for you, okay? The meat put in front of you is for you, but you cannot touch it till I tell you, okay? Remember, the officer says, doggy Johnny, you cannot touch the meat unless and until I ask you to touch it, okay? And then this dog, you know, it's very hungry, it's gone for a walk. So the dog thinks in itself, you know, see, if I look at the meat, if I keep my eyes on the meat, what in 1 minute, I'll just gulp it down. I'll do one thing. To avoid temptation, what I will do? I will look to the master. I will keep my eyes fixed on him. I'll keep my goal on my Lord. I'll keep my eyes on my master. Then I can overcome this temptation. And you know what the dog does? It stops looking at the meat. It starts looking at the master. It starts fellowshipping with the master. Now today, for you and me to overcome temptation, to overcome instability, to overcome whatever this chaotic life we are facing, the secret to overcome is we have to look to the Lord. Look to the Lord more and more as time goes on. We should increase our fellowship time with the Lord. We should, you know, even as we behold his holiness, even as we behold his countenance, His qualities come into us. In Romans 8, I won't show you many scriptures. In Romans 8, 29, it says, the reason why we are born here is so that we could be transformed like Christ, so that his countenance will get reflected on me. So even as days goes on, I should become more like Jesus. It's a beautiful song. It says, to be like Jesus, okay? To be like Jesus, to be like Jesus. All I ask is to be like him in all life's journeys, from earth to glory. All I ask is to be like him. Yeah? Even as days goes on, the more we spend time with the Lord, the more we see the God of Bethel, the more we spend our time in the presence of the Lord, the house of the Lord, not only the church, his feet is the place where we can meet the Lord. That is when we become more like him. You know, we get that radiance from the Lord. We get that, because as youngsters, we all like to look good, you know. Can I tell you, sister, young girls, see, when I was young, of your age, from that time, Fair and Lovely cream was there, okay? And those days, the advertisement was, if you used Fair and Lovely in 4 weeks, you'll become very, very fair. No, from last 30 years, I'm using Fair and Lovely. I've not become fair. One shade, I've not become fair. Okay. So we all want to look good. We all want to look presentable. We all want to have blemishless skin. We don't want pimples. We don't want acne. We don't want holes on our faces. We all want to look good. That's physical. But today, the Lord, he'll give that beauty also. Yes. But with that added is, when we spend time with the Lord, when we see this God of Bethel, when we spend time, you know, and when we fellowship with the Lord, and when we enjoy his presence, his countenance will reflect on us, you know, his glory will reflect on us, and his brilliance will reflect on us, and eventually we'll become beautiful. We all want to look beautiful. We all want to look outstanding. We all want to look very, very separate from the rest of the people. Yes, this is possible when we spend time with the Lord in a spiritual way, okay? So that's the first pillar, okay? So the Lord is saying the first pillar, he used it as a fellowship, okay? The second one we see in Genesis 35, 14. I'll read. So Jacob set up a pillar in the place where he talked with him, a pillar of stone, and he poured a drink offering on it, and he poured oil on it. So Jacob set up a pillar in the place where he talked with him. No, the second place where we see this pillar being mentioned in the Bible is when God spoke. Okay. So God spoke to Jacob. When did he speak? When Jacob set up a pillar. Okay. So you and I are a pillar. And that pillar indicates it's the fellowship with God, the first one. And the second one, when the Lord talks, you know. So The more we talk to the Lord, the more blessed we are. Now, we have the phones and, you know, all this free talk time is given, and, you know, unlimited network or unlimited, network and all this, unlimited is there, no? So sometimes even, I have as youngsters, you know, I mean, as youngsters, when we were a group, you know, in our MSC, we now have a group also. And we have many groups, you know, where sometimes we chat also, you know. Okay, some are unbelievers, some girls are unbelievers. We do chat. Sometimes we end up, you know, chatting. There was one time I was traveling in a bus, and there was this young girl sitting by my side. And go to see, the moment we were supposed to go, maybe the travel was around 6 hours, okay? And the moment I got in, this girl started chatting on the cell. You won't believe, children, by the time I got on, it was early morning, 6:30, till that time, she didn't sleep a wink. She was continuously talking. And she was shouting. I guess the other person she was chatting with could be a man. And sometimes she would stop chat and she would talk on the phone. And she was literally scolding that guy. She was saying, how dare you cheat me? How dare you go for another girl? How dare you? So I understood, you know, before I went, I gave her a track, you know, and I almost asked her, you know, I understood that that guy who was talking to her was having many affairs, okay? And this girl was still behind him, you know, chatting, okay? So I almost told her, why do you waste your time? Why do you waste your precious heart? Why do you throw your precious heart to some unworthy fellow, to a useless fellow? What does that fellow do? He will not even care for your heart. He will not even care for your emotions. He will not even care that you are a precious child of God. but I didn't tell her that I gave her a track and got done, you know. So what I'm telling you is the second pillar mentioned in the Bible is where when Jacob spoke to the Lord or when God spoke to him. So the second pillar, as you and I, we need to talk to the Lord. You know, the more we talk to the Lord, the less troubles we have. The more we fellowship with the Lord, the less trouble we have. Chat with the Lord, commune with him, talk to him, read the scriptures, you know, and that is when the Lord will really help us, okay? Many times out there in the world, people think that people do not value us at all, you know. I had a friend in my degree college. She had on a Valentine's Day, February 5th, 14th, one guy would come. And the next year, she had one more boyfriend. So 3 years, she had three boyfriends, you know, that kind of a life. You know, she was a Christian for that matter. What a saddening thing it is, no? So the second pillar mentioned, it talks about talking with the Lord, you know, fellowshipping with the Lord and conversing with the Lord. The more we converse with the Lord, the less problems we have. And the third pillar is in Exodus 24th chapter, 4th verse, you know. We're just trying to understand that the Lord thinks that you and I are a strong pillar for the Lord, built as a palace for him, okay? Exodus 24th, 4th chapter. 24th chapter, 4th verse, it says, and Moses wrote all the words of the land, and he rose early in the morning and built an altar at the foot of the mountain and 12 pillars according to the 12 tribes of the Lord. And Moses wrote all the words of the Lord. Isn't it a wonderful thing? And he built 12 pillars, and 12 pillars indicate the 12 tribes of the Lord. No? So what does that mean? Remember, Moses went onto the mountain to write what the Lord would tell him. So that he could convey the message to the Israelites, right? So when he went to the mountain and when he came down, he built 12 pillars according to the 12 tribes of the Lord. And Moses wrote all the words of the Lord. So the third pillar mentioned here in the Bible, the many pillars I told you, but only for our lesson, we're just dwelling on four pillars. The third pillar talks about the word of God. You know, I don't know how many of you have finished reading the word of God or finished reading the Bible. I mean, I'm never into that, you know, because when we start off to finish the Bible, maybe in 6 months, you know, it becomes a monotony. Go to see, I never read the Bible even once, I'm not right, you know, because I did start many a time. I did start from Genesis, I did start from Matthew, but I ended up reading maybe after 3 or 4 books. It's become a habit for me, like how you just automatically, involuntarily, how you brush your teeth, how you comb your hair, it's become like that. You know, it's become very, you know, very burdensome. It's like, you know, suppose this night I have not read, I have to read. Come on, let me read 5 chapters. You know, I was not enjoying the word of God. Please do not do that. The Lord has helped you to read the Bible many times. Praise God, hats off to you. But do not do like me, because it didn't work out for me. What works out for me is, even if it's one verse, I would like to sit in the presence of the Lord, think about it, and get volumes of beautiful thoughts from the Lord. That's what I like. I really, in front of you, I'm confessing that I've not read the Bible even once. I tried to do that. It didn't happen. It didn't work out. Maybe it works out for you, but please do read. If your mommy says, finish the Bible in 1 year, finish it, okay? It really works out, fine. But it was not working out for me. But what works out for me is, even if it's one verse, even if it's one chapter or 10 verses, I want the Lord. I will say, Lord, I will not leave you till you teach me a spiritual lesson from here. Yes, I still need to work on completing the Bible. Yes, I still have to do that. You also pray for me. Okay. So the third one is, the pillar is built, and 12 pillars are built. And that's an indication that the great man of God, Moses, got the word of God. He got it written. You know, the Lord has written on the tablets, and once he broke them, you know, again he had to write. So the third one, the lesson which we learn from the pillar is, we have to read the word of God. Okay, so that's the third one. And the fourth one, we see Jeremiah 1:18. It's a very beautiful verse. I really like it very personally. Jeremiah 1st chapter 18th verse. Jeremiah 1st chapter 18th verse. If you have the Bibles, right? 1:18. It says, I'll read, okay. For behold, I have made you this day a fortified city and an iron pillar and bronze walls against the whole land. Okay, whatever it is, an iron pillar. So the Lord is saying, we are iron pillars, you know, a pillar which is made of iron. So far in Psalm 144, we just heard about the pillar being built of concrete and iron, right? And what is inside the pillar? Maybe outside it's concrete and cement and all the color, but inside the the strength of the pillar stays in the inner material. And what is the inner material? The good iron, you know, cast iron. The more strong the iron is, the more strong the pillar will be. Okay, so the Lord is saying, you are an iron pillar, for behold, I have made you this day a fortified city. A fortified city is a city which has a good, what is a fortified? The boundary, you know. In olden days, every city had a boundary wall or a wall, you know, like we have Great Wall of China. Every city had a wall around. It's a very, a big wall, a very broad wall, a very strong wall, okay? So the Lord is saying today, you know, it says, so the context is different. It says, you are a fortified city and an iron pillar. So we are not weak. Even as we said, Y-O-U-T-H, you know, defined us, you know, as youngsters, we were what? We just try to understand how weak we are. But the Lord is saying, you might be weak, but remember, I have made you as a fortified city. Means he has given a hedge around us, you know. No Satan can touch us. No temptation will befall us, because the Lord is saying, I have made you as a fortified city and also I have made you as an iron pillar. So today, as God's children, we are firm in the Lord Jesus Christ. We are not shaken, you know. Temptations come. Remember, temptations do come. They will come, you know. So as youngsters, we will tell you, there could be many boys who would say, I love you. And sometimes your best friend who is a girl might have a boyfriend. And when you see that your friend has a boyfriend, you also might feel like having a boyfriend. And suppose all your classmates are going for a movie, which is a very hilarious, it's a movie which is very good. And you also feel like going, you know, that's a temptation, right? And we feel like going, and we feel like in socializing with youngsters, we feel like dressing up like them. We feel like dressing up with tight t-shirts. Maybe we dress up with short skirts. All these things we see outside in the world, right? And when they look at us, they think we are village folks, you know, out of the red bus. Let them think we are standing for the Lord, you know. So the Lord will help us if you keep praying, because the Lord says you are a strong pillar. You're an iron pillar, and your foundation is so great. On Christ, Lord Jesus, the firm rock I stand, you know, not everything else is sinking sand. The whole world is sinking sand, okay? People, youngsters who expose themselves, you know, who wear tight t-shirts, they invite unwanted trouble, you know. As youngsters, there was a TV show which I did many years back, you know, and there were many questions as young girls and boys had asked me. And they asked me about dressing, you know, they asked me, should we not wear, you know, these modern dresses, tight dresses and all. I said, you wear whatever you want, but remember, you should, when what dress you wear, that dress should not carry a tag of look at me, okay? Suppose I'm going to the market, many boys are there and I'm a young girl and I have a tag like this and I have a tight t-shirt. There was a girl, you know, my friend, she had a tight t-shirt and on the t-shirt, the word juicy was written. Juicy, can you imagine, just after the meeting, you think about it. On the t-shirt, it was a tight t-shirt and the chest was very wobbly. And on that is written juicy. When boys look at that, what kind of thoughts will the boys get? And will not those boys follow her and even try to propose to her and say, I love you, and try to do all bad things? So we are inviting trouble. So children, we are strong pillars and we need to dress up in a way. I don't say every time just go like this, gungat met gungat dalke. So don't be like that. Let's be modern, but you have to be modest. Be modern, but be modest, okay? And we should never dress in such a way where we carry a tag saying, look at me, okay? So if you're so attractive in a bad way, then every Tom, Dick and Harry, every dog in the market will follow you and they'll say, we love you, I love you. And if you say no, they'll try to do all kinds of blackmail. So we need to be very careful. As strong pillars, we need to stay very safe in the hands of the Lord, okay? And the Lord, the word of God says, you are strong pillars fit to be in the palace. You know, we are in the palace of the Lord. We are not ordinary pillars. We are great pillars of honor. We are great pillars of worth. We are great pillars of glory to be as foundations for this great palace. So even as we think about this, I'll just tell you two more points and I'll stop, okay? So as God's children, when we know that we are pillars, I'll give you a few scriptures so that they can really help you. Help me also, because these scriptures have helped me when I was a youngster, okay? So the first problem we face is, you know, sometimes we have a lot of fear. And we are very timid many times, you know. Sometimes we think, though the Lord says we are pillars, though the Lord tells we are strong, though the Lord tells, you know, that you are in my hands and I engraved your name on my palms. in spite of all that, as youngsters, we encounter a few problems. And the first problem is we have fear and we are timid, okay? Why we are fearful? We are fearful to think, see, that gang is there. And because I don't fit in that gang, they will try to, what will they try to do? They will try to avoid me. And they'll try to joke on me. They'll keep me away. And I feel aloof many times. Dear children, we all have gone through the pangs of loneliness. There were times when, because I did not fit into them, they have abandoned me. Because I have not fit into them, they have not shared the notes which I've suppose one day I was absent. They did not share the notes with me because they didn't like me. Okay. So God, Jesus has been lonely many times. He was left alone many times. Many people abandoned, even his 12 disciples abandoned him. Can you imagine when he was about to be trialed, when he was taken to the Pilate, when the high priest, all disciples abandoned, everybody abandoned. He was all by himself. If you are lonely, if you're feeling lonely, maybe you do not fit in. Maybe your friends just take you for granted. Maybe your friends, they think you are just one black sheep. It's okay. Let them think, because we are the greatest friend. The greatest friend is a friend who's very faithful, who's really genuine, who's there all the time, nurturing us, taking us into our arms. Okay. So let's not be fearful whether I fit in there or no. What about my friendship? You know, how will I handle, you know, if I'm all, imagine you're in a college or in your professional college, and during lunchtime, you're left all alone and nobody's sitting with you. Okay. Sometimes the things do happen like that, you know, and we are fearful. But remember, it says in 2 Timothy 1:1, for God has not given a spirit of fear. Do not be fearful at all, because the God of heaven is your friend. Okay. And it says, you know, for God has not given us a spirit of fear and timidity, but of power, love, and self-discipline. Okay. So the Lord is by us and he's saying, why do you worry? Are you lonely? It's okay, my child. I've been lonely. I know what it means to be lonely. In my loneliness, I tried to see the face of my Father. Okay. So dear children, if you are feeling lonely, if you are feeling left out, or if you think you're not fashionable enough to be able to get along with your peers, okay, or get along with your friends, it's okay, don't worry, the Lord is by us, the Lord understands, and I'm sure the Lord will give you good friends. Every time, I would not like to tell that, but every time my daughter would go to a new institute, she would go to a new school, I would not pray for her academics, I would not pray for her marks, I would pray, Lord, help her to have good spiritual friends. Lord, everywhere she goes, help her to have good spiritual friends, good Christian friends, Lord, and friends who are very positive. I do not want friends who have boyfriends who talk about all the filth in the world, who talk all nonsense in the world. I do not want such friends, Lord. No matter how rich they are, no matter how posh they are, I do not want those friends. Children, try to be very careful when it comes to choosing your friends. Okay, so that's one beautiful passage. The Lord says, I have not given you a spirit of fear and timidity, but of power and strength. Okay, and the second problem youngsters face is, you know, sometimes we all fail, right? We all fail in the sense, not actual fail in the exam. We might expect 98 marks, but go to see, we get only 85 marks. Okay, so life is full of failures. So many times, as parents also, we try to put children in a mold and say, hey, come on, you need to get 80, 98, man. If you don't get 98, you'll use good for nothing. You know? So that way, it's very bad. It's a lesson for parents like us also. It's okay. You know, we need to handle failures also. We have been failed. You know, we have failed many times. Yeah, we have failed in keeping up our spiritual fervor. We have failed in our academics. We have failed in coming up to their expectation, right? So sometimes it's okay. We need, as God's children, we need to handle even failure. All the time, you know, every time we are in success, every time we are talking about success, that's okay. But we also need to understand, sometimes the Lord will make us go through that valley of darkness. He makes us go through that valley of tension. He makes us go through that valley of tears where, you know, where we have nobody else and none else but the Lord Jesus Christ, okay? And that's a very few beautiful verse. It says, the second one, when we go through failures, whatever it could be, maybe there was a drama in the school, and maybe first they thought that they'll put me as a leading star, but later they found somebody else, so they removed me. That's such a big, I tell you, heartbreaking for youngsters. If you're not into the arts, right, or maybe singing was not good and they replaced you. That's such a big, and everybody's performing, and you were supposed to perform, but you're sitting in the audience, just watching them. How heartbreaking it is, right? So the second thing we need to handle is failures. It's okay if we fail, it's okay. Maybe if you're not perfect, it's okay. Maybe our painting is not perfect, it's okay. Maybe our English is not good, it's okay. But the Lord thinks of you, I mean, in a high way. Okay, the Lord thinks you're awesome and great. That's the second. Philippians 4:13 says, "For I can do everything through Christ who gives me strength." It's the Lord who strengthens. It's the Lord who will give you talents. It's the Lord who will make you as an iron pillar, right? So that's the second problem. Two more problems I'll tell and I'll stop, okay? And the second and the third, the problem is we are very anxious about our future. What future holds for me, especially in this pandemic? We counsel many youngsters, you know, many youngsters, they keep calling us and they talk to us. What about our jobs? What about our courses? And what about our semesters? And where will we go from here? And people, youngsters who are in the job, they have the fear and the anxiety of losing their jobs. And go to see out there in the world, many people, many youngsters during this pandemic, they're going through a phase of depression. They're going through a phase of uselessness. They're going through a phase of despair. They're going through a phase of distress. Don't know what to do. They're wondering what our future holds for us. We do not know. So for youngsters, it's a lot of anxiety. What kind of job they get, what kind of a husband they get, what kind of a spouse they get, how their future will be, what will happen to this, what will happen to that. There are many questions, but dear children, don't worry, you know. So there's a beautiful verse in the Bible. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. For today, the Lord gives us the grace. It's okay. Let's enjoy today. Let's not worry about what happens 1 month from now. Let the Lord do the worrying. Let's cast our whole burden on him, okay? And let's enjoy every moment the Lord is giving us. The Lord is giving us a beautiful time to stay with the parents, to stay with our sisters and brothers, to stay with a sibling, to stay with our family. Let's make the best of it. Let's sing unto the Lord. Let's worship the Lord. Let's write beautiful songs. Grace and Glory have some beautiful songs. The others are yet to sing, right? So the Lord is giving us so much. So let's redeem the time. Let's not worry. Let's not be anxious at all. And let the Lord doing the worrying, let's cast our burden on him, okay? And for that, it says, Jeremiah 29:11, it says, the Lord says, keep away all anxiety away from you, because for I know the thoughts that I think, that I plan toward you, says the Lord. I have plans more than your mommy, daddy. The Lord is planning your life. More than your own kith and kin, the Lord is planning your life, okay? It says, the Lord, the thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope, okay? So the Lord is more worried about you. Then let the Lord do the worrying, okay? And the fourth problem, we go through is, you know, we worry about a new situation, okay? So many times, suppose people who have finished their inter, they go on to the professional course, okay? And many youngsters are worried, what kind of friends will I have? Will I be able to overcome, you know, the, what do they say? They tease, no? What do they call it? First years, they tease the second years. The second years and the fourth, they tease, no? What do they call? That word I'm under. Afterwards, you tell me, okay? So many youngsters, you know, they have a lot of fear about, you know, the new avenues in your life, you know, how my life is going to be, how the professional course is going to be, how this is going to be, how that is going to be. So many things, you know, but whatever it is, don't worry. It says, you know, Joshua 1:9, it says, be strong and of good cheer. Do not be afraid, nor be dismayed, for the Lord God is with you. Okay. So when the Lord God is with us, there's no worry. There's no need for us to be worried. So the Lord is giving us new avenues, new places to go. Maybe sometimes so far you've been in the comforts of your house. Suddenly, suppose youngsters who got a job, you have to relocate to a new place. That's totally new culture, new food, new language, away from mommy's lap, away from mommy's cuisine, away from dad's comfort, away from the church. And it's a totally new version of your new life. It's okay. The Lord is going to travel with you. Maybe it's a new college you're going to enter. Okay. Maybe it's a new class you're going to enter with new friends and new teacher, you know, and there's so much of apprehension. There's so much of fear in your heart, you know. But praise God, the Lord is saying, be strong and of good cheer, because I will be with you, the Lord is saying. So, dear youngsters, make sure to take the Lord along, no matter where you go. Take him along to your school, take him along to your college, take him along to your job place, take him along everywhere, and he'll stick to you as a faithful friend. He's a faithful friend, such a faithful friend, and he will never let go. So, our situation at home sometimes is different. So whatever it is, you cling to the Lord, cling to the anchor Christ Jesus, and he will really help you through, okay? So may the Lord bless this session, and may the Lord help all of us to understand what it means to be a mighty pillar for the Lord, to be engraved in the palace, like, you know, or sculptured in the great palace where many kings and queens come, and the the greatest king of ours is the king of kings and the lord of the lord Jesus Christ. So you and I are a pillar when I was weak, okay, but we are strong in the hands of the Lord. May the Lord bless this word. Thank you so much for coming in. There've been many people, you know. Thank you so much. It's been a beautiful time. So we'll close the session with prayer. Okay.